name, believe. And for those of us who believe, but just in case, there are some who are not quite there yet. In Matthew chapter 13, verses 53 through 58, for the final message text for today, Matthew chapter 13, verses 53 through 58, and I'm reading from the New King James Version, and it says this: Now it came to pass, when Jesus had finished these parables, that he departed from there. When he had found his own country, he taught them in their synagogue, so that they were astonished and said, Where did this man get this wisdom and these mighty works? Is this not the carpenter's son? Is not his mother called Mary, and his brother James, Joseph, Simon, and Judas, and his sisters? Are they not all with us? Where then did this man get all these things? So they were offended at him. But Jesus said to them, A prophet is not without honor, except in his own country and in his own house. And he did not do many mighty works there because of their unbelief. He did not do many mighty works there because of their unbelief. The cost of unbelief. The cost of unbelief. In the text for today, Jesus had returned to his hometown of Nazareth and did some teaching in the local synagogue or place of worship. His teaching was so eloquent, so profound, that the local people were just amazed that Jesus taught so well. They asked in verse 54, Where did this man get this wisdom and these mighty works? Prior to returning to Nazareth, Jesus had been in other places teaching and working miracles. And the word was out that he was the long-awaited Messiah, the great deliverer, and no doubt word had somehow trickled back to his hometown of Nazareth. But the local folk, hometown folk, were having difficulty in grasping that this was indeed Jesus doing these things. They were having difficulty because they knew him as Joseph and Mary's boy. Yeah. Jesus was from humble beginnings. His family was humble and ordinary. Just an average family and nothing more. His father, Joseph, was a carpenter. His mother, Mary, was a housewife and mother. Neither parent had achieved any prominence nor had any of the children risen above by giving any promise of any more than the other children of Nazareth. That's what Bryson said. So in other words, they only saw Jesus as the local kid now grown up, but they could not accept the fact that he was capable of doing what he was doing. And because of this, it says in verse 57, they were offended at him. The word offended means that they stumbled over him. They could not accept the fact that Jesus, the local boy, was the Messiah, the anointed one. Their stumbling over him amounted to unbelief, not trusting him. And then in verse 58, Jesus made a statement concerning the visit to his hometown. Now, he did not do many mighty works there because of their unbelief. It did not say that he did not do any mighty works. It said that he did not do many mighty works there because of their unbelief. In other words, their inability to trust Jesus cost them. Their lack of faith cost them. Because of their unbelief, some folk were not saved. Some folk were not healed. And some folk remained in the bondage of fear, the bondage of despair, the bondage of joylessness, the bondage of weakness, the bondage of living a mediocre life. They missed out on that abundant life that Jesus came to offer. All because of their unbelief. Now, we probably read that passage and feel somewhat sorry for the people of Nashville. We may even view them critically and ask, how could they not believe him after all they had seen and heard? What more could Jesus have done to prove to them that he was indeed the Messiah, the anointed one sent from God? Well, audience, it is my responsibility today to inform us, that we are not that much different from the people of Nazareth. I'll be the first to admit that we are a blessed people. I'll be the first to admit that God is good to us. But how many blessings are we missing because of our unbelief? We're not trusting him as much as we should. And our unbelief, our lack of faith is costing us. Now, there might be some here watching on whatever it's called, YouTube, whatever it's called. How dare you? How dare you stand there and cast that kind of judgment on us? And if you had stones, you might be willing to throw them my way or give me some kind of nasty look or even murmur under your breath. How dare. But the truth is the truth. We're not trusting Jesus as much as we should. We have the teaching of Scripture that informs of his amazing abilities. We have his indwelling Holy Spirit to encourage us. We have our own testimony of how God has worked in our lives. But in spite of all of that, the faith of many has not grown beyond Jesus' ability to save us from sin. We trust him for salvation, and that's about all it is. There are those who are still living under a cloud of doubt, fear, and the ability to trust Jesus wholeheartedly. And this unbelief, this lack of faith is costly. It's costly in that many are still caught in the grip of sin. Jesus is the Savior, and if we would just trust him, sin's dominion over a person's life can be broken. Sin's dominion can be broken through faith in Jesus Christ. You weren't born to be a drug dealer. You weren't born to be a drug dealer. drug user. You weren't born to be sexually promiscuous. You weren't born to be a thief or an adulterer or an adulteress. You weren't born to live in despair. Your status can change from sinner to saint, from being spiritually blind to gaining new sight. Jesus is the Savior, and He's still in the saving business. Nobody is beyond Jesus' inability to save.
That's right.
And every day, He's offering salvation.
Yes.
This unbelief is costly in that many are still caught in the grip of despair. They are not living a life characterized by joy, by peace, by strength, and hope. Jesus specializes in giving all of that and more. He specializes. Sister Shirley Carruthers used to sing a song, God specializes.
Uh-huh.
He specializes. He's a specialist.
Uh-huh.
He's a deliverer. Remember, He is the one who was nailed to the cross, but by the power of God, He was raised from the dead and declared that all power in heaven and earth is given in His hand. And I love 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 through 5. I love that passage. It says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who, according to His abundant, more than enough mercy, abundant mercy, has begotten us again to a living hope, a vibrant hope, not a just get by, but a living, a vibrant hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Trust Him. biblical witnesses. And I'm about to. Two biblical witnesses. If you need a scripture reference, it's 1 Kings chapter 17, verses 8 through 15. There's a widow woman in a place called Zarephath. A widow woman who was poor. All she had was enough food to make for herself and her son. Didn't have extra. But there came by her way a man of God named Elijah. And God had told Elijah that a widow woman is going to feed you. And this widow woman told Elijah, all I've got is enough food for my son and myself. And he still had the audacity to say, fix mine first. Pray. church if only we trust him. And I'm not complaining, I'm not fussing, I'm just making an observation. God blessed this church in that we needed an air conditioning unit to replace the one in this sanctuary so we can stay warm in the winter and cool in the summer. This church took from our reserves and paid cash for the unit. And all we asked was that the church members would just replace the reserves. Where Bryson's been? How long ago has that been, brothers and sisters?
3 years.
3 years, and we still have not replaced the reserves.
Oh!
Poppy will bless me with whatever I need. My children know, and all my grandchildren know, they don't have to want for nothing as long as Poppy and Gigi are alive.
Amen.
You know, we want our children to experience life in all of its fullness, not being small-minded. The world is larger than your neighborhood. The world is larger than Nashville, Tennessee. And my God is so awesome. You came to deliver us. My final statement. Thankfully. We're still writing our story. Thankfully, God is giving us more time. But let us just be sure that the ending statement to our story, our lives, is not this. Jesus did not do many mighty works in their lives because